Previously on Balls.
Got me.
Yeah, we got you loud and clear. We're hoping it is Neil Collins.
Yeah.
You look like a yob.
Sorry, mate. I've had a swim. What's happening?
There we go. Neil Collins out at Centurion. I shouldn't say where you live there.
Out with the chaos you've been.
It's a big area. Neil's been fighting with people again this last week.
That's how it is.
How are you doing, sir?
Yeah, no, I'm good. Yeah, very excited about South Africa against Ireland rugby at the weekend, and of course Bafana coming up. And we had a really good weekend of football, unless you're an Arsenal fan, of course.
No, please don't get me going.
I know, I just can't really get over it. But Gordon's come out today and named his squad. He's made some changes in the goalkeeping area. He's got rid of Maneep Josephs and
why?
Wayne Sanderlands.
Is there still issues around the earlier issue with Maneep, or is it a different thing? Is he just maybe looking at other options, or what?
He's looking at other options, mate.
Okay.
This lad Keats doing really well overseas. He's the form goalkeeper, and as Gordon said when he got this job, he's going to stick to the people in form. Maneep didn't have the best of games for Pirates yesterday, letting in those two goals after the 90th minute in the Telkom knockout, which has kind of ruined their chances of a treble this season, another treble. But I don't think it's to do with that. I think he knows that Kune's been in good form against Poland and Brazil. He knows that Kune is back to something like his best, and he wants to have a look at Keith, probably just in training.
Yeah, and this guy used to do what you did, Johnny.
Yeah, same sort of thing, Dan.
What, Johnny?
Medical repping.
No.
Oh.
he used to parachute into... He's done over 1,000 parachute jumps.
1,000? I only did 53.
Have you never heard of parakeet?
I thought I'd get the lame
pun in before John gets his first on in the street. It's taken you a while, Johnny.
Yeah,
stop it. Are you losing your touch, Johnny?
All right, so Gordon's still on there, sort of look-see what I've got. I mean, compare him to Hendrik Meyer. I think Hendrik gets more people on his back than Gordon does. Because they're both in the same situation. Let's have a look-see what we've got.
There's an enormous similarity between the two situations. Heineken Meyer has picked quite a number of players because they're experienced in Europe. And I think he's got a reasonably easy ride over the side he's picked for the three big internationals in autumn. But Gordon's only got AFCON to worry about. I mean, has anyone told Heineken Meyer he has to get to the semi-finals of the next tournament or he has to get to top five in Africa and all that kind of thing? No, they haven't. And Gordon has particular stipulated pressure on him, you know, from SAFA when he was appointed.
Big difference though, Neil.
Yeah, well, Heineken will always be in the top five of the world, won't he, with
exactly.
His Springbok?
Yeah, I mean, it's hardly likely they're going to drop out of the top five. The Springbok rugby is always...
You don't have 244 FIFA-ranked or IRB-ranked sides either, do you?
Yeah, I mean, rugby is basically your 10, maybe 10, 8, 8, maybe even 8 to red countries where, you know, the top tier, whereas football to get... You know, to try and achieve what South African soccer wants to achieve, I mean, it's a completely different kettle of fish.
It's a whole different thing. Listen, they play at Soccer City on the 14th against the AFCON champions, the Zambia. Mm. And I see Zambia, I was going through Zambia's side. Southampton, there's one Southampton player in there. That's the only real kind of powerhouse kind of side that they can look at in their entire squad. They've got five or six from South Africa. They've got the Kennedy and Wiener, the goalkeeper at Free State Stars. He takes penalties. He's a good goalkeeper. He was one of the stars of the Zambian performance against the Ivory Coast, against Didier Drogba. And it'll be a really, really good warm-up, I think, for Gordon. He's starting to settle his side down, but of course, as is always the way, he doesn't have a lot of time.
Mm.
January the 19th, this all kicks off. I'm a little bit concerned about a few things in the background from the LOCOG, from the AFCON LOCOG, the tickets... You know, where to get them. People are still coming on to me every day and saying they can't get tickets from super spas and they're struggling with the internet. But, you know, if the tournament goes well and if Gordon, you know, we got that quite a reasonable qualifying group, you know, then Gordon knows what he's doing. I quite like the squad he's put out. He still hasn't picked Andile Jali, who looked like he was limping at the end of the Pirates game yesterday. He's going to look at Sangweni and Kamalo as his centre-half kind of stalwarts and he's found some kind of shape. It's up front that it's interesting. You know, Benny McCarthy is now fit again. He scored in a friendly on Saturday against Amatux. And Benny's just going to come back for Pirates probably on Wednesday against Sundowns at Loftus. I went to that game last year. I'll go on Wednesday night. It's a sellout. Loftus is sold out for that game. You know, it was last year. It will be this year.
Mm.
And if Benny was to come through and to score a couple with his particular nose for goals that he has, I'm not saying he's the fittest or the best runner we've got, to put Benny McCarthy and Tequila Ranti up front, the lad that was at Pirates, and let him go, and he's now playing for Malmo and getting goals, you know, we could look at a situation where Bafana start to kind of rescue a little bit of pride and salvage some honour for a country that has the best domestic football in Africa in terms of cash.
Yeah. Kenox?
Possible.
Neil, interesting enough, Gordon Eggerson...
Why are you wearing shades?
I don't know. I thought they were quite cool. They're not shades.
Just in case anyone... No one is looks some Kate or anything. She's not sporting
looks
a
like
shiner.
Stevie Wonder's daughter.
Yeah, but just in case. People might think, why is Kate? She's covering up her black eye or something. Just like, you know, people might start thinking or wondering. So, yeah, anyway.
Anyway, Neil... Gordon says he's going overseas to look at other players, but he's not only meeting David Sommer, but he's also chatting to Stephen Pienaar and saying that he hasn't closed that door on him. What's happening there?
So Robin Peterson came out during the AFCON draw and said they're still trying to get hold of Pienaar and still trying to find out exactly why he doesn't want to play for his country anymore. And that David Moyes doesn't want to be without Stephen Pienaar from January the 19th, you know, well, actually from Christmas, if Gordon gets his way, all the way through to the middle of February. Everton simply can't afford to be without Pienaar for that space of time. Pienaar has paid something like 1.2 million rand a week to play for Everton. He's paid, 50 grand to play for Bafana. Benny McCarthy's been down that road. Aaron McQuena. I think you'll even find Lucas Radebe and Philemon Masinga and all those lads. They always came across this problem. So Gordon has gone over to achieve the unachievable and say to Stevie, look, when Christmas comes, mate, you've got to consider your nation first ahead of your club. But I'm afraid that with Rob Moore, his agent, going on holiday with David Moyes and stuff like that, there's almost no chance that Pienaar will play. And then you've got the problem with people on the social network saying that Pienaar, he's never produced much for Bafana. But they forget, Iggeson's never managed, he's never coached Stephen Pienaar. He's never had him. If you had Kagiso Dikashoy and this Furman lad from Oldham,
so how do you say that name again? Please, we've had a big debate in the studio.
Dihachi, Neil.
Is it Kagaki? Sorry,
Dihachi,
John.
Shut up, John.
like the British commentators do. If you listen to the championship, where Kagiso Dikashoy is a regular for Crystal Palace, they've just got a new manager in. Holloway's just come in at Crystal Palace and taken the place of Doogie Friedman. And Dikashoy is impressed there. He's a hero in South London, and that's where they call him Kagiso Dikashoy. So I'll stick with that today. We'll change it next time.
Tell you what, when he's in South Africa, we call him and then we'll ask him how he says his name. How's that, Johnny?
Yeah, it's a bit like Lucas Radebe. He was never Radebe.
Yeah,
absolutely, Radebe. I was the one that used to always correct them on that. But listen, the point is, if you had Pienaar on the left of a solid midfield, instead of Pizzo always used to play him kind of central because he thought he was the best player he had, then you might start to see the best of Pienaar with Punch Masanimele coming down the left, and you could actually create an outlet that will create goals for, you know, Tequila Ranti in the important games. So the ideas are all there. Iggeson is doing all he can. He's pulling it all out. But, you know, believe you me, there was criticism when they lost to Poland. There was pressure. And Heineken Meyer, you know, if he thinks he's above the pressure, if Gary Kirsten in the World T20 thought he was above the pressure, no, these are international management jobs. No one is safe for more than two or three games, you know. There's almost no honeymoon period. And Iggeson goes into this game. Imagine if at Soccer City on the 14th, if Zambia were to pull it all out and to win 3-1 with Collins and Basuma, the Orlando Pirates guy, back in favour with Zambia. Imagine if he was to get a couple against Bafana. Gordon will find himself in serious trouble before South Africa hosts AFCON. So he's taking risks. He's doing all he can. And I admire Gordon, and I like the way he stays in contact with us all and the way he lets us know what he's thinking. You know, I think
Sorry, Neil. Just hold on 1 second. We have a mystery person on the line, and all we want you to do is that you.
Who's who?
You.
Is that you?
It's me.
Yes, it is you. Okay, I recognise it. All we want to do is please pronounce that Kagiso footballer's name for us, because you're the only one that does it properly.
Which one
Dwayne.
Is that?
Like Kagiso Dick.
As far as I know, it's Kagiso Dikachwe.
Thank you.
Hold on, just say it again, please, without interrupting. Say it again.
As far as I know, it's Kahisho Dikhachwi. I've also
Dikhachwi, not Dikhachwa.
No, Dikhachwi. That's what I've been saying. No, you say Dikhachwa.
Dikhachwi. Okay.
Sorry, carry on.
I've also heard him called Dikhachwa. I've heard both.
Okay, but you used to say Dikhachwa. Joy.
Who said that?
You used to say Dick. You used to have the click in the middle.
Who are we talking to?
Never, Peter. Never. You've never said that, Peter.
It's not Peter.
I know it is.
Okay.
There was once a time when I mistakenly believed it was a click, but he's actually, I think, from somewhere in the Eastern Free State originally. So
no click.
It's actually Chwa or Chwi, as far as I know.
You led me up the garden path.
The clicks are from the Eastern Cape. I'm from the Eastern Cape.
I swore blindly that you were the only one who pronounced it correctly.
That's where I live and learn.
That's where I learned it from.
Thanks, buddy.
Cheers,
Peter. Ciao, bye.
Who was that?
Who was that?
He works at another radio station, but I didn't want to get him fired.
Right, listen.
Well, they probably like to be.
Dikhachwa.
Yes, okay. Anyway, you were saying.
Okay, his middle name is Evidence. And I know how to say Evidence, okay? Evidence, like that. And it's fine.
But it wouldn't stand up.
You know, as far as I know, he's born in Brantford. And Brantford, to me, is, you know, resettlement camp territory when I was a kid. And they used the click everywhere there. So I think there probably is a click. Yeah. And I think we have to look at that quite closely, okay?
All right, let's move on.
I do my utmost to reflect the Crystal Palace pronunciation of KD's name, okay?
There we go, call him KD.
And I believe in him, and I think he's loved in South London. He's got a few goals this season, and yeah, he's taken his criticism. But there's no Andy Lajali to keep Teke Madisa. Did I say that right?
Yes.
He's doing fine, but not considered yet as a starter by Gordon Niggerson. You've also got today the Telkom knockout semi-finals.
Yeah.
Predictably, they gave a Bloemfontein derby. Well, a Free State derby, Free State Stars against Bloemfontein Celtic. If you watched that game yesterday, Darren, you and I love our football. It's your great secret, isn't it? Your passion for soccer.
Where I started, Neil.
Yeah, and that was an absolutely magnificent game yesterday. That 3-3 draw, 90 minutes, Pirates leading 3-1, 3-3 draw, off to penalties. Great save from the Cameroon goalkeeper, whose name I'm not going to try and pronounce. And it was a great game. And more games like that, and South African football will take centre stage.
It's all about the product. All right, yeah. So that's it. The one game that really depressed the crap on. I didn't even want to watch it because I could see it coming. But afterwards, I just said it is time because clearly it was like schoolboys playing against the masters. But Arsene Wenger, I'm sorry, it doesn't matter how pretty the football is, but after so many years, and we're heading nowhere again this year, and now they're coming out and saying, no, they're going to invest in the January window and they're going to buy some guy. Did you read that? This guy they're going to buy from Lyon.
No, there's all kinds of stuff. No, this is what Wenger always does. He now comes up with all these things he's going to do and all these players he's going to buy. BBC have got a couple of them dropping on live now and names coming out in the press conference today as he desperately tries to protect himself from the continuing criticism.
He must go now. I'm sorry, but he must go.
Well, you're lucky. I mean, your boy's too young to phone you from London and berate you for making him an Arsenal fan like my boy does at 25. I can only say that if Arsene Wenger left, Peter Hill Wood and the skinflints that run Arsenal are not going to suddenly give someone like, I don't know, Pep Guardiola $35 billion to spend or whatever it is that the PSG have spent in the last 2 years.
Get Harry in. You give him a bit of a year supply of bitter and he's happy.
Who's that, Harry?
Harry.
Harry Redknapp.
Get Harry in there.
That would lead to civil war in London, riots,
who cares?
The cancellation of the Olympics. I know we've had that. But the point being, if you took Arsene Wenger out, much like when Alex Ferguson eventually leaves Manchester United in 2032, when he's 95, you've got a situation where, you know, people will look back and they'll say, well, Arsenal always managed to finish in the top three without spending much money. Now look at us. So I'm not with Piers Morgan on this and the 3 million Twitter followers that retweet him. I'm with Arsene Wenger. A month ago, when we beat Liverpool, everyone was saying, you know, this could be a good side. And Cazorla was a great signing. Podolski, not a bad signing. Giroud, probably.
What are they doing? It's all good and well getting these great signings if you can't put them together on the field to actually do something.
What about Mauro and Chamakh? What about,
crap,
you know, Giroud and Jovinho?
Crap.
These are players who were top quality signings, and they've done nothing. So you're right, there is now this review of the Wenger, you know, genius. Steve Bould is now his number two after Pat Rice was there 85 years. And Steve Bold.
Sorry, excuse me. Steve Bold. He was great in that Arsenal back four with Tony Adams and that. But seriously, how the frick do you concede 5 goals to Reading?
Well, that was in the.
Then what is your defensive coach actually teaching them?
Have you got a Premier League table in front of you?
Are Reading above Arsenal?
The best defence in the Premier League this season is Arsenal. It's conceded 8 goals. They've conceded less than Chelsea.
And almost doubled that in one League Cup game.
Yeah, but the League Cup game was brilliant, wasn't it? That was one of the most unbelievable games you'll ever see. But yeah, no, of course. I mean, they said 2 weeks ago, on all the pundits were saying if it was anyone else but Arsene Wenger, this guy would have gone by now. You know, year after year, he promises X, he comes up with Y. Like we're saying today, why the hell is he there?
Yeah.
And you've got to ask, how is he ever, you know, going to restore confidence? Well, it's quite simple. If they were to win the Capital One Cup, bearing in mind they got Bradford in the quarterfinals, which is a great draw, then suddenly things will turn around. You know, football fans are fickle beings. And Arsene Wenger, and I've always said this, if Platini ever becomes head of FIFA and he puts in his financial restrictions on football teams, Arsenal will be the last top side standing.
Yeah,
and
I think that much I agree with, yeah.
That's what Arsenal are waiting for, is for even Aston Villa and sides like that, and QPR this last 6 months, they'll all get told you're spending too much, you can only go 30 million over your income every year in terms of spending. And we'll suddenly find that Arsenal fit in with the financial requirements of FIFA and UEFA, and Man United don't, Liverpool don't, Chelsea, Man City.
Liverpool don't anyway.
Sorry?
Liverpool don't, and look where they are.
Yeah, well, I'm much more comfortable talking about Liverpool or Spurs having lost to Wigan than I am talking about Arsenal. But I must say that for all the fact that I'm not a great fan of Luis Suarez, I put up a video this morning of the Suarez goal, because those three touches that he scored with to equalise for Liverpool against Newcastle yesterday were fabulous. And the bloke has got immense talent, Luis Suarez, when he's not falling over his own feet.
Yeah, exactly. And for Bernard Rodgers to start making comparisons with Messi, I mean, come on, please do me a favour.
Yeah, they both speak Spanish and they've got dark hair.
That's it. That's it. All right, Neil.
I've got great finishes.
And West Ham in eighth, Neil.
Every journalist in London is a West Ham fan, so I spent my life arguing with hammers, and they're not always the most gentle of people. It's a bit like coming from Pretoria West or south of Joburg.
Easy now.
You come from Pretoria West, don't
no,
you?
No, I don't. Close to it, though.
The point being that Hammers fans are tough geezers, and they've been through a lot of rubbish. Sam Allardyce is just the right man for that job. He's put them up there. They're knocking it about with the big boys again, and it's known as the academy, and they produce good players. It's nice to see West Ham back up there. But, you know, I can't look beyond Chelsea Man United again, and that distresses me enormously. You know, the Man City, having bought their way up there, I don't think they're going to do it. I think it has to be Chelsea this season with that midfield. The most sensational
so early in the season.
Young.
All right, well, it's a long way to go, so I'm sure we will be chatting. Now, listen, why don't you get your New Age newspaper to come and sponsor your own show here? So we don't know.
Yeah, I'm speaking to various people.
Are you?
Are we going to meet in McCarlysburg sometime?
Yeah. Huh?
Come to our team building.
Come to our team session. Thursday.
Yeah, yeah. It's going to be fun. No one owes anyone money.
And he's a prick. He's a prick. He's a prick. Yeah. It's not a team building. It's a team strategy session.
I won't be there, Neil.
There you go. Colors like that one.
Thanks, Neil. We'll chat to you sometime.
I'll come along and give you a motivational talk.
We've only booked the place for the day.
Yeah, we've only got 8 hours. Thanks, Neil. Chat to you later. Love to Jules.
Ciao, ciao.
Bye. There we go, Neil Collins.
Cheers, Neil.
Getting his own, inimitable contribution to the show, as always.
Invaluable.
This is Paul's Visual Radio. Darren, Simon, Kate and John. Weekdays from 3 p.m. to 6 p.m. Central African Time. Bulls.co.za.